things I'll pass around, but this is an off-the-shelf knee replacement, so I'll talk a lot about what the difference is between an off-the-shelf knee replacement and a custom knee replacement. And I think if you hold these in your hands, you'll see the difference, really. So this is every knee replacement company that makes knee replacements is this, except for one company, which is this, and that's what I'm talking about tonight. But you can see the differences, and they're subtle, but this is the same size implant. So if this was, this actually is probably a female knee. It's a size 3 DePuy, which is a very common knee replacement people use. So a lot of what I want to talk about is just trying to explain the difference, what it means to be an off-the-shelf knee implant versus a custom knee replacement. Because the custom knee replacement, a lot of people say that, but what they're doing is they're not actually giving you a custom knee replacement, they're doing other things. So that's kind of what I'm going to talk about. So I'll pass those around. This is also another prop, but so a lot of places when they say they're doing a custom knee replacement, what they're really doing is they're getting an MRI of your knee, and then what they do is they make these jigs that fit on your knee. So a lot of people are like, oh, my knee was made in Belgium. There are no knee replacements made in Belgium. What they do is they make these things, which are cutting guides. So they're 3D printed cutting guides that go on your knee. So when you're, as a surgeon, these are really helpful. So basically you do your knee replacement and you put this on the knee, and this thing is made for the patient you're operating on. And then what that does is it tells you the exact resection to make of the bone. They still put in a symmetric implant. So this is, if the implant itself isn't custom, the cutting guides that the surgeon uses to do your knee replacement are custom. That's a very a subtle but very important difference. Anyways, let's get started. I'll just go with it. And sorry for the cameras, but just feel free to ask whatever questions you have. So so basically, kind of this, we're at, I think, a really important turning point in medicine. So we have a balance. So we have this ability now to maximize technology. So the things that we're able to do now with smartphones, I mean, just your cell phone itself is a technological marvel. So there's so many things that we can do from a technology standpoint to improve medicine. And orthopedics is kind of lagging behind a lot of other areas of medicine. So you look at cardiology, they're putting in valve replacements percutaneously. So those are all things that had to be done open. So I'd say a lot of orthopedic stuff is lagging behind. But we're also in this era of cost savings. So we have this problem where all these people are getting older and they're needing more healthcare. So the healthcare dollars are getting squeezed. There's more people needing services. And so really, what do you do? I mean, do you offer, you try and do everything as cheap as possible, or do you try and give everyone the nicest thing or the most cutting edge thing? And that's not really for us to talk about tonight, but I just think in the end, patients will decide what's best for them. You know, I don't think we should really have our legislators telling us what's best for them. I think really in the end, patients will decide what's best for them. So thanks for your time. It's good to be back in the Midwest. Like I said, I grew up around here. I grew up in Mineral Point, Wisconsin. And one of the mottos at Southwest Health is just to take care of patients like you'd want to be cared for. And my personal motto, which I use a lot for patients when I talk to them, is one of my mentors in Seattle was an old Texan, and he would just, when we'd present him cases like, this person broke this, we could do this, this, he'd always just say, what would you do for your mother? And with a Southern accent. And I kind of approach a lot of patients like that. I have patients come see me and they're like, well, what should I do? And I'm like, well, if you're my mom, I tell you to do this. And, you know, I think if you treat people like you would your relatives, then I think it makes the decisions really easy. So I just passed around the implant trials, the props, and for the things for you to look at. And there's models up here if you want to look at them as well. But if you have any questions about them, feel free to do that. So this is just a background about where I've been and where I've trained. So I grew up in Mineral Point, born and raised, spent my whole life there for elementary school, middle school, high school. Then I got done, I went to college at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. I spent 4 years there, it was awesome. I then spent 2 years in Philadelphia. I went to Drexel University in Philadelphia. I went to school there. And then I came back and went to medical school at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. So I spent a lot of time in Madison. And when I got done with medical school, I got to go to the University of Washington in Seattle for my orthopedic training, which was my top choice. And orthopedic training is, it's like all surgical professions, it's very grueling. I can't tell you, I saw a lot of Seattle when I was there, but it was a really good experience, and I think I learned a lot. When I was there, I then made the decision that I wanted to do just hip and knee surgery. So my career kind of changed. Initially, I was going to be just a hip and knee surgeon only. So I decided to do a fellowship, and I did a fellowship at the Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. So that whole year, all I did was hip and knee revision. So basically, I saw a lot of people had problems with hip and knee replacements that we helped revise. And then I did an additional year of training after that, where I spent a whole year in Rochester, New York, and that was mainly sports-based surgery. So ACLs, rotator cuffs, some shoulders, some revisions. But anyways, that's just my historical background of where I've trained. So basically I did 7 years of surgical training. And since then I've been in Platteville for about 2.5, 3 years now. And basically I just drove back and forth on I-90. I didn't stray off the highway. So I left Madison with the Seattle, went back to Boston with the Rochester. So that's kind of where I've been. So a lot, yeah, go ahead.
I have a question. Why did you choose Platteville versus UW?
That's a good question. So my father was an OBGYN in Mineral Point, and he would wake up every day and either go to Dodgeville Hospital, Platteville Hospital, or Darlington Hospital. So he basically went to the three hospitals. And what I really liked about his job is he had a lot of autonomy. So he didn't have a lot of people telling him he had to do things. He also didn't have all these committees. He didn't have a lot of partners. So basically he got to do kind of medicine the way he wanted to. I initially was gonna go back to Seattle and join the staff there. I was gonna go back and join the faculty. And I just thought to myself, I just think I'd be happy coming back home. So we had kids too. So I mean, that was another big thing. And my wife and I are like, oh, let's go back home. And then I thought about joining an academic practice, but the other thing is I didn't want to just do one thing. So like most of the time, if you're in academic practice, you just do hip or knee replacements, or you just do spine surgery, or you just do, you know, hand surgery. And I think there's a lot of things as a general orthopedist you can do and be really good at. So that was kind of my decision, I guess, and really happy with it so far. So it's a good question. The other question I get is people always ask, like, why do you go to different places and train to different places? And a lot of that's kind of hard to explain unless you know how surgery residencies work. But when you're a resident, you have 5 years of training as an orthopedic resident. Your first year is a general surgery intern. And that year is you're basically just learning medicine. I mean, you graduate medical school, you know all these things. You don't really know how to apply them to patients. And then you really have 4 years to learn how to do surgery. And then by the time you start getting good at that, it's when you finish your residency. But you still have a lot of things you got to refine. And so during my residency years, I did 3,000 cases. But of those where I was actually doing a lot of it myself and be autonomous, it's not 3,000 cases. It's a lot less than that. When you're a fellow, it's different. I mean, you're a fellow, you're treated as a junior attending, and you're doing a majority of the surgeries by yourself. And you're doing complex surgeries. So you're doing like big surgeries you normally wouldn't do as a resident. So my fellowship year when I was in Boston, I did 417 hip and knee replacements, and a majority of them are revisions. So those are big surgeries. And I think when you do big revisions like that, when you do primary knee replacements for the first time, it's just, you know, you're just like, well, I've seen all the ways you could possibly, you know, screw up a knee replacement. So you just avoid those things, you know? So I just think it gave me a lot of background that was helpful. And then the other thing is I knew I was coming back to Platteville. So I made the decision to come back to Platteville, and I was like, well, I'm going to be by myself. I'm not going to have any partners yet. I mean, hopefully I'll get some partners, but I just know that all the surgeries I do there, I need to be really proficient at and good at, because I literally am operating on people, my teachers, people I see in the grocery store every day. So I know I need to do really good. So I guess a little bit of added pressure.
So you're the only one in
mm-hmm. here? Yep, I'm the only one for now. There's also a physician assistant who works with me. He and I work really closely together, and we're very busy. So we're thinking about getting a partner. So if you know an orthopedic surgeon who's looking to come down to Platteville, let us know. So what do I do? I mean, this is just a general slide. I mean, I do for shoulders, I pretty much do everything for shoulders. So I do rotator cuffs, I do slap tears. I mean, there's basically everything shoulder I do. I do replacements, I do reverse total shoulders. Hands, I do basic hand stuff. I don't do really complex hand things. So carpal tunnels, trigger fingers, those are really, really easy kind of things to do. Wrist fractures, things like that. If there's something complicated like tendon transfers, I send it out to university usually. Hips, to do almost everything. I don't do hip arthroscopy, so that's definitely a need around here. There's not a lot of people doing hip arthroscopy, but I do hip replacement, hip revisions, knee scopes, ACLs, meniscal surgeries, total knees, revisions, and I do a lot of fracture care. I don't do everything, but I do a lot of stuff. I don't do any spine surgery, and I don't do any feet surgery, so those problems I usually send out. So basically the goal is just to introduce myself, which I kind of already did. I want to talk to you about the good things that are going on at the hospital, which we already did, and basically, I just want to educate patients about total knee replacements, because I get asked a lot of questions when I see people as patients, and I always have to ask them, like, where are you getting that question at? Can you just tell me, like, what the background is? Because there's a lot of misconceptions about knee replacements and how they're done. And a lot of it has to do with advertising, and also a lot of it has to do with just things that people have been told. And like I said, ask questions. It's open for you guys to learn. And also, if you have to leave, I'm not offended if you have to go. So I'll talk a little bit about the prevalence of arthritis and how this is becoming an increased problem. I'll talk to you a little bit about what is knee arthritis. So people ask me all the time, they're getting ready to have a knee replacement. Like, what is arthritis exactly? There's a lot of different treatment options for arthritis, and I'll kind of go through those, and I'll talk to you briefly how to perform a knee replacement. So we'll get you a certificate when you leave here. And then I'll talk to you about custom knee replacements versus custom cutting blocks and what the difference is. So this is the problem. So this slide shows the problem. So if you look at this, these are two graphs. And if you look at the graph here, this is the knee replacement graph. And then the bottom one is the hip replacement graph. So this graph tells a lot about what's going on. So if you look at, this is 2005, it's about 500,000 knee replacements a year. 2015, about 1 million a year. 2025, there's supposed to be 2 million knee replacements a year. And you look at 2030, 3.5 million knee replacements a year. And this goes back to we have this huge demand for these procedures because patients are getting older, they're still maintaining their activity level. But the interesting thing is you see how hip replacements really doesn't change much. And the reason for that is hip replacements are largely genetic. So you'll see families where everyone's had a hip replacement in their family. And a lot of it's just like dogs, where there are certain breeds of dogs that have bad hips. There are certain patients who have just the genetics where they're set up to have bad hips. Whereas knee replacements, we think there's a lot of factors that go into knee replacements as to why people get knee replacements. So it's not just purely genetic. So if you look at the top 10 causes of disability amongst US adults, arthritis is number one. Back and spine problems are number two. So that's all orthopedics. And then the rest of it's heart problems, lung problems. There's a lot of other things that are gonna keep physicians busy, but the leading causes of disability are really orthopedic related. A lot of people ask me, why did I get arthritis? So a little bit has to do with genetics. So we talked about that with hips, but some people have bad knee cartilage as well. And I use the tire analogy, which is kind of a simplified analogy, but I tell people, some people were born with really good tires and they'll never get arthritis. Some people were born with really good tires and they misbehave. And some people are just born with bad tires. I mean, you see people who are really young and have really bad arthritis and they're like, what'd I do? And it's like, well, I don't really think you did anything wrong. I just think you got dealt a bad hand when you were born. And I tell them to blame their parents. But there is definitely an association with weight. And so I think part of that graph as to why there's such a large increase in people needing knee replacements has a lot to do with our weight problem in America. So if you look at the prevalence of arthritis in people relative to weight, this is a big problem. And so part of the issue with this is that cartilage doesn't have a vascular supply. So your knee cartilage in your knee is basically the way it gets its nutrients is from the synovial fluid. So when people get heavier, their cartilage sees a lot more contact stress and contact pressure. So I think in general, people think that's what's causing this increased shift of people needing knee replacements. The other thing is your knee sees a lot of shear stress. So when you bend your knee actually, the cartilage is seeing a lot of stress that your hip typically doesn't see. Your hip is more of a ball and socket joint that spins. So there's a lot of reasons why we think there's this link, but it's definitely an association with the two. So this is just some basic stuff about knees. So in general, we describe the knee as having three compartments, an inside, an outside, or a medial and a lateral, and then a kneecap compartment or a patellofemoral compartment. So a lot of times when, you know, doctors, I think we start talking about things, we start getting a little ahead of ourselves. A lot of times patients don't know what we're saying because we're making a lot of assumptions. But basically when you look at a knee, we're looking at the inside and outside of your knee and your kneecap as all three different places. So some people get arthritis just at their kneecap, so they get patellofemoral arthritis. That's a different treatment than a total knee. Some people get arthritis just on the inside of their knee, and that's also something that's a different treatment. Sometimes people can get a partial knee replacement. So a lot of times when doctors talk about it, they talk about you having tricompartmental arthritis, and what they mean by that is having it in all three spots. So here's an excellent x-ray. I hope my knee looks like this. This is probably an 18-year-old kid. So what you can see on the inside of their knee that they have this space there. So when you get an x-ray actually tells an orthopedist, because we look at x-rays all the time, a lot about your knee health. So when I look at this person, I'm like, well, they have really good space there. So I know that this whole space is filled with cartilage. And I know that this whole space here is filled with cartilage. So this person has no arthritis. I mean, it doesn't mean they don't have a problem with their knee when they come and see me in clinic, but I know that we're not talking about a knee replacement with this patient because their knee looks really good. This is a lateral, the same patient. And you can see here that they have really good cartilage between their kneecap and their femur. So this person doesn't really have arthritis. It's probably some high school kid who hurt his knee playing basketball. So this is what arthritis looks like when you look at it when you're doing surgery. So when someone's getting a knee replacement, this is what their knee always looks like. So basically what arthritis is, it's the breakdown and the wearing away of cartilage. And then what happens is it causes the bones to rub together, and that results in pain. So this is a schematic, obviously it's not a real picture, but you know, people have bare spots where there's no cartilage. And usually they have a lot of joint fluid. So people will come in like, oh, I have Baker's cyst, my knee always swells. And that's basically your knee's response to having arthritis. So this is a bad knee. This is a knee x-ray of someone who's got a bad one. And what you see here is there's no space. You can see that the body has made a lot of extra bone, so you got all these bone spurs. And then what happens over time is the knee becomes corrugated and it kind of fits into its own groove. So it makes its own track because there's no cushion left. So this person's got a pretty bad knee. And then here's the lateral, the same knee. And you can see he's got bone spurs. So this person's got a bad knee. Doesn't mean they need a knee replacement. That's the other thing. I see a lot of people who come and see me and they have really bad x-rays. And I ask them, does your knee hurt? And they say, no. I'm like, well, then you don't need a knee replacement. Because there's a lot of people who have really bad arthritis, but their knees don't hurt. And I just tell them, just be thankful. Because there are people like that. Usually it's around the Christmas time and holiday season where people are like, their parents are telling them to come in, you know, their children are telling their parents to come in because they're limping. And they'll have x-rays like this. And I ask them, like, you know, what do you do on a daily basis? And if you can do all the activities you want to do on a daily basis without pain, then don't have a knee replacement. I mean, knee replacement is really for pain relief. So symptoms associated with arthritis, I mean, this is pretty obvious. Some people have a hard, but I always ask people, what is it that you can't do? Because it really helps me kind of figure out what's going on with your knee. Some people are like, oh, I'm fine, but I just can't go upstairs. You know, that's a different problem than someone who says, I can't get out of bed and I can't walk. I mean, there's two different spectrums of a problem there. They both could have really bad arthritis and x-ray. Some people have problems just when they get up in the morning or they have startup pain, they get up out of a chair, they walk, it hurts, but after that they're fine. And some people just don't like the mechanical symptoms in their knee. Like some people come in, they're like, my knee just grinds and I don't like the way it feels. So a lot of those things are helpful to kind of figure out what treatments you should have or try. So this is kind of the arthritis treatment algorithm. This is, I have this conversation like every day, 15 times. So basically there's a lot of things you can do and you don't ever have to have a knee replacement. Our body doesn't know about knee replacement. So you could live your entire life without having a knee replacement. But here's the things that most people try before they come and see me. Most people try and modify their activities. So there's always something that bothers them, gardening or some activity they don't want to do because it hurts. Weight loss is probably the best thing for you, but it's always the hardest. So if you look at your knee, when you go from sitting to standing, you put 4 to 6 times your body weight through your kneecap. So I always tell people to lose 5 pounds, it's really 20 pounds off your knee. Anti-inflammatory medications like ibuprofen, Aleve, Motrin. Some people can't take them because they're on blood thinners. There's always those problems. Tylenol, which is helpful, but it's not as helpful as ibuprofen for arthritis pain. Again, some people can't take them. There's tons of supplements, and people ask me a lot about the supplements. I always tell people, if you think it helps you, I'm okay with you taking it as long as it's not expensive, because there's so many supplements out there. Not a lot of them are proven with any science, but if something is working for you, I don't have a problem with it. So that's a very common question people ask. One of the common supplements that people take is some version of chondroitin sulfate or glucosamine. And the reason for that is when it came out, there's a book that came out and basically said that it was a cure for arthritis. And the idea is that they're cartilage byproducts. So people are like, well, if I take cartilage byproducts, will I get cartilage back in my knee? That was kind of the theory behind it. But really what we think it works is a mild anti-inflammatory. So they're in dog treats, things like that. But if they work for you, fine. But the problem is a lot of times they're very expensive. There's steroid shots, so you can have injections. I'll talk a little bit about that. There's steroid shots, and then there's also lubrication shots or gel one injections. There's a lot of other things you can do, so, and I don't have any problem with this. So some people go to the chiropractor on a regular basis, some people do stretching, some people do a lot of topical creams, magnets. Brett Favre's got some gold thing that I saw on TV yesterday. If it works for you, that's great. And I can't tell you try this or try that because I can't tell you the science behind a lot of these things, but if it helps you, great. Physical therapy, sometimes people want to go and see a therapist and that can help strengthen your knee. It doesn't change the actual mechanical symptoms you're having in your knee if you're having a lot of arthritis, but it's definitely worth a try. And then there's actually braces that people can wear that what they do is they shift your weight on your knee. The problem with the braces are they're expensive and they're big. So I would show people, I have a couple in my clinic and they're definitely something to try if you're like looking to avoid surgery. And then the other thing is a cane. I mean, a lot of people don't want to use a cane. They don't want to be seen with a cane, but canes actually really do help prolong your need for having anything done surgically. So knee injections, there's a lot I could talk to you about this, but basically there's two general varieties of injections. There's steroid shots, which are a very strong anti-inflammatory. There's lots of different kinds of steroids, and people would debate which steroids are best. And then there's the lubrication shots, or the hyaluronic acid injections. So basically the steroid shots, the way they work is they work in the same way as ibuprofen. They're an anti-inflammatory. So you put them in your knee. People usually get pain relief from them. There are some people who don't respond to them. In general, you can get them every 3 months. And people always ask, well, am I hurting my knee by getting my knee injected? And I always tell people, if you're getting it injected for arthritis, the horse left the barn. We're just trying to prevent you from getting a surgery. So I mean, there's nothing wrong with having cortisone shots if you're looking at my other options, knee replacement. If you're a 20-year-old kid, yes, you shouldn't have knee injections with steroids. Hyaluronic acid is very controversial now. So basically the background story is that they came out with a lot of different versions of it. So there's like Synvis, Monovis, Gel One. There's tons of companies that make them now. And the problem with them is originally when they came out, there was a lot of articles saying how great they were, and they had a lot of positive response with patients. The problem was is there's a lot of conflict of interest with the authors who wrote the papers. And now the majority of the organizations, such as the American Academy of Orthopedic Surgeons, have actually recommended against giving these because they're not as effective as steroid injections. And they're expensive. So what I always tell people is if you want to try them, I'm not against them. I don't think they help as much as steroid injections, but I'm not going to tell you you can't have them. It's your knee. So. When am I ready for a knee replacement? I get asked this all the time, but basically, I want you to be pretty miserable before you have your surgery done. So I always tell people, you want to have daily pain, you want to have it interfere with the things you want to do, or you'd be significantly stiff. I guess that's the other two. When people start losing the range of motion, then I think it's time to make that decision. Or your knee's unstable. So there's a lot of different reasons why your knee can be unstable. Sometimes people are like, my knee will buckle on me, and that can be associated with the arthritis, or sometimes people have ligament problems with their knee, like to have an ACL tear. But basically I tell people you need to have arthritis on your x-ray, you need to have tried an exhausted conservative treatment, and then really you gotta make the decision for yourself whether you wanna go through with it. So I don't like this picture, I put it up there. I hate when people are on the beach. We don't have a beach around here except for Mazo. But basically the goals of surgery are just to relieve pain. I mean, that's the idea behind it. And hopefully get you better function and mobility. There's a lot of other things people want to accomplish with a knee replacement, and you just have to be, I think the patient and the physician just need to understand what the goals are. So I always ask people, like, what is it you want to do when you get done? You know, and if you want to go rock climbing, okay, that's a pretty high demand thing. Maybe you can, but I think if you're able to rock climb before you have a knee replacement done, then you're still functioning pretty high. So these are the things I think most surgeons think about, is what are the complications you can have. So surgeons always think about these things, and you know, the patients are just thinking about, you know, I just want to get through the surgery and get my life back. You can have an infection, you can get blood clots, you can have a medical complication afterwards, such as a heart attack or a stroke. And some people afterwards, for some reason or other, their knee just gets really stiff and they get arthrofibrosis where their knee doesn't bend well. So those are all like very serious complications you can have after surgery. They're all not common, but it's something that I think patients need to know about. Then there's problems that are implant specific. So your implant can become loose, you can wear the implant out, and some people just have persistent pain and it's hard to explain why, even though everything looks okay on an x-ray. And then the other thing is afterwards, I always tell people the surgery takes about an hour. You'll be in rehab for a long time, but the whole goal of that is to get your knee moving and get your knee ready to be kind of done with your acute medical care. So it really takes a big investment for patients, so I always want to make sure that patients are on board with what they're signing up for. The worst thing you can do is operate on a patient, have them not do therapy afterwards. You're better off not operating on them. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about knee replacements now. This has all kind of been background about what knee arthritis is and knee replacements and pros and cons. But basically what I think of a knee replacement as a knee resurfacing. So some of the first knee replacements were done actually by dentists. And it's very similar to putting a cap on a tooth. So basically what you're doing is some people think you're taking the whole knee and tossing it. But basically what you're doing is you're really resurfacing the knee. The other thing I like to talk about is like, what is off the shelf? What's an off the shelf implant? So this kind of gets back into the knee replacement I'm using versus what everyone else is using. So every hospital has a room like this. So basically this is an inventory room of implants. So when a knee surgeon is doing your knee replacement, what they do is they they measure your knee and they're like, okay, they're about a 6.5. I'm gonna make it into a 6. And they say, go get me a right 6. And then someone goes in the implant room, they look for a right 6, they come out and they open up a right 6, and then they take your knee and they shape your knee into a right 6. So that's how knee replacements are done. So this is, everyone has one of these, it's an implant room. And so basically what they're doing is they're trying to make your knee into an implant shape. And what they do is they make these implant shapes to try and fit the majority of people, but not, they're not specific for each person. So every single implant company that makes knee replacements is this way. The only difference in the knee replacement companies, which we'll talk about a little bit later, is the name of the company, how many different sizes they have. Some has 3 sizes, some have 9 sizes. I think every company has a right and a left now, but there's not a lot of variability. So all the off-the-shelf implants are similar because they're designed to fit the majority of people. So they're basically a symmetric condylar design on inside and outside of the knee. And they increase the femoral component in the side view, usually in 4 millimeter increments. There are some companies that make them 2 millimeter increments, but the implant itself is symmetric. And then with the tibia, basically what they do is they try and fit the majority of people's tibias. And everyone's tibia is kind of goofy shaped. So what they do is they make a symmetric implant. A lot of the companies, you can use their tibia in either the right or the left knee. So they're basically a universal kind of half circular shape thing. So you can put the same 6 in someone's right knee as you can their left knee. So they're not really specific to anything. This is an example of one of the companies that makes knee replacements. And I like this company a lot because they have the most sizes. So there are certain patients who I don't think are good for custom knee replacements. And I'll talk about that later. And when I do, I use this company because they have the most sizes. But you can see how basically the sizes are all identical to one another. They just change their width and depth a little bit different. So there's a lot of patient-directed advertisement. And this is the thing that I get a lot of people who ask me questions about. So I always have to ask them what it is specifically that they want. So I have people who say, like, I really want a visionary knee. And I'm like, what is it that you want about a visionary knee? And then they tell me something, and I'm like, well, that's not, anyways. So there's a lot of misinformation out there. But there's a lot of patient-directed advertising. So there's a 30-year knee, which hasn't been around for more than 15 years, but it's the 30-year knee, so that's what they call it. There's the get-around knee, which is Stryker. A lot of people ask if I do a minimally invasive knee replacement. I think everyone does that. I mean, everyone tries to make it as least invasive as possible. There's mobile-bearing knees, there's gender-specific knees, there's ACL-preserving knees, and then a lot of people are trying to do outpatient hip and knee replacements, which is another topic, but I'm happy to talk about it if you want. It's not something I'm trying to do. And really it comes down to this. I like this slide a lot. So basically the slide says, hey, is that the new wheel? Yeah, it's completely redesigned for this year. What's that little marking for? It's for the resale. So the difference between these companies is not much. So if you look at all these companies, they have this history of making a knee replacement, and all they do is they change the brand name of it, and then they also add some feature to it. So either they add a couple extra sizes to it, but the whole thing comes down to the radius of curvature. So every company has a patent on the radius of curvature. And this is the thing that no matter what company you're using, each one has a radius of curvature. So this is Stryker's, the get around knee. So they have a circle as their radius of curvature in the back of their condyle. So no one could make that same curve because they'd be infringing on Stryker's patent. Same thing with Zimmer. Zimmer has this 113 degree arc. The thing is all these companies, what they do is they, every 10 years, they change the name of their implant. And then so the get around knee was the triathlon. No, it was the, can't really implant I had before that. I don't use Stryker. Zimmer, they used to have the next gen. So now they have the Persona. But this is the same. The only thing that's different is they've increased the sizes that they have available. So it's not really a new technology that's going into these other knee replacement companies. Basically, they're just changing the name. So DePuy had the Sigma, now they have the Attune, and it looks identical because they have the same radius of curvature. And like I said before, in those implants I handed around, the condyles that they make on these implants are symmetric. So this is an even, these are the condyles. I keep talking about condyles, but they're kind of, people are like, what are condyles? But basically, your knee on the inside and the outside, kind of like your compartments, everyone's knee is not symmetric. No one's knee is symmetric. I haven't seen one yet that's symmetric. But the implants they make are symmetric. So this is symmetric and this is symmetric. Why is that? Well, because they're trying to get an implant that they can fit into a lot of people. So they try and make it symmetric. So then as a surgeon, we have to do is trying to adjust the implant to trying to accommodate each patient's anatomy. But your knee is a very complicated thing. So this is a study that was done. It just shows your knee kinematics. So when your knee is in extension, your femur actually slides forward on your tibia. And then when you bend your knee, your inside your knee stays put, and the outside your knee rolls back. So your knee is actually a very complicated joint. It's not like the hip, which is a ball and socket and just pivots. Your knee actually bends and rotates. So that's kind of the problem that some people have when they have a knee replacement done, is their knee is fine when it's straight, it's fine when it's bent, but midway through, about mid-flexion, people's knee feels, they feel loose to them. And so they're like, yeah, my knee's fine when I'm walking, but I go downstairs, I don't trust my leg because I feel it's gonna give out. And a lot of that has to do with you're putting in a symmetric implant and your native knee wasn't symmetric, then you're gonna have some mid-flexion instability problems. So that's kind of like the problem that all orthopedic surgeons are trying to figure out, is how to fix mid-flexion instability. So these are the parts of a knee replacement. So basically, all knee replacements, you have a femur, then you have a tibial component, and then you have a piece of plastic that goes on your kneecap. We keep your kneecap. People always ask me, I had a patient today, he's like, did you keep my kneecap? You always keep the kneecap. It's just whether or not you put a piece of plastic button on or not. So when you're doing a traditional knee replacement and you're opening up a size 6 or a size H or whatever company you're using, basically all the condyles are standard, the groove standard, and the plastic is standard. So the only variable as a surgeon you can change is the alignment and picking the right size. But I already told everyone that very few implants fit anyone perfectly, so you know you're getting a size that's close. And then surgeons have to get the alignment right. So that's the hard part, is getting the alignment so it's always lined up perfectly every time. So this is where a lot of the custom language comes in, that people say they do custom knee replacements, and really what they're doing is they're getting alignment aids for the surgeon to help make sure your alignment's correct. So this is, that's the custom cutting blocks. Traditional navigation aids or alignment aids is typically how most people put their knee replacements in. This is how I was trained to do it, but basically you put a guide on the outside of the tibia and you line it up like this and you're like, it looks neutral. And then you look at the side and you're like, that looks right. And then that's, you make your cut. That's your eyeball. And the one thing I've learned is I don't think my eyeball is as good as I think it is. Navigation is an attempt to kind of use some of the technology we have. I use navigation occasionally, and some people have really odd shaped knees. What it does is it basically uses an accelerometer similar to your cell phone. And so what it does is it helps you get the alignment correct, so it actually is neutral, what you're aiming for. But it's an additional guide to help aid you in surgical alignment. And then the custom cutting blocks, like I was passing around, I mean, that's really what most people use when they say they're using a custom knee replacement. They're basically making cutting blocks to make sure your alignment's correct. Your implant's still made here in America, and it's still not custom. So custom cutting blocks, these are all the companies that have, I mean, every company has them. So they call them different things. So Zimmer has patient-specific instrumentation. Biomet uses Signature, that's the one that's made in Belgium, but again, it's the plastic pieces that are made in Belgium, not the implant. The implant's made in Indiana. DePew, they have a True Match. Smith & Nephew has a Visionaire, and then Stryker has Shape Match. So these are all the cutting jigs that you put on when you do surgery. So this is the templating software that comes with that. So here's a Zimmer knee I did. And again, I like Zimmer, I think it's a really good company. But this is a patient's knee, this is actual a patient of mine I did. So this is the software that comes, and I've taken all the patient identifiers out of here, but so you can see this patient's knee is not symmetric, but it's pretty close. This person actually, their knee is pretty basic. But you can see over here how the implant's fitting. So there's a lot of uncovered bone over here. The problem is sometimes people have it where this actually overhangs. So anyways, this is how you template and make those cutting blocks. And this is what it looks like. So this is the software I get. So basically this patient, I'm gonna have a lot of bone over here that's not covered. I'm gonna have this big chunk of bone over here that's not covered. And this is the best I can get this tibia to fit on this person. And you can see the condyles are symmetric. So this is how most knee replacements are done. And then this is what comes, like those things I passed around. So what you do is you put these on the end of the femur, you put these pins in, and then you use these cutting jigs to make your cutting the cartilage off that's arthritic to put the knee replacement on. So these things are really alignment aids, they're not custom implants. So why do people not like their knee replacement? So the conversation I always have people when they want to have a knee replacement, I say, if you look at the studies, 10 to 15% of people don't like their knee replacement. And sometimes you don't know why. So about 80, 85% of people are happy with their knee replacements. And usually the people running around telling them how much they love their knee replacement, how they wish they would have done it when they were younger. But there's definitely a lot of people who don't like their knee replacements and they've had them revised. So why do people not like their knee replacements? So a lot of it, we think, is because the implant's improperly rotated. So rotation, some people have problems with instability. So that's probably the most common reason why I did a revision during my fellowship training, is that whole story where someone's like, yeah, when I'm walking, I'm fine, but I go downstairs, my knee's unstable, or I'm getting up from a chair, my knee gives out on me. So basically it's a ligament problem. So basically it's a balancing problem. And it's usually what it is you're putting a symmetric implant on someone whose knee is not symmetric. And there's problems with alignment and polyethylene wear. But you look at a lot of knee replacements, and this is what they look like. There's areas of bones exposed, you have some overhang. Is that the cause of why someone's having an issue? Maybe. But I always ask the question, what's the point of a knee replacement? What's the goal from a surgical standpoint? And really what you want to do is you want to reproduce the patient's anatomy, and you want to put the implant on so it's perfect. I mean, basically you just want to put back what the patient had without arthritis. I mean, that's the goal. And this is just, there's tons of studies on this, like why people don't like their knee replacement. So basically femoral component overhang is a big problem. So there's a lot of people who are really petite women, and then you have to use an implant that has a lot of overhang. So people get overstuffed, they can't bend their knee. There's a lot of studies on this, why people don't like their knee replacements. And then the other thing I always tell people is the gender specific thing. So one of the companies made a gender specific knee, but then they stopped calling it that because the problem is as a surgeon, you're trying to put the best fit in the patient. So if you're using a size 6 and it's a female, but the patient's actually a male, then you know that always creates a problem. People are like, well, what knee did you put in me? And really what you're trying to do with knee replacement, it's not a gender thing. You're just basically trying to get the knee that fits the best. So a lot of times they'd make the gender as narrow or wide, and you just make a decision looking at the patient's knee, well, this person's wider, I'm gonna use the wider one. It's not necessarily a male knee, it's just a wider one. So they stopped doing that. And really you can't do anything based upon someone's gender or size. So what I'm here to talk about, the thing I'm doing, which you've probably seen advertised, there's other people around using it, but is a customized knee replacement. So what they do is they're able to make a knee replacement that's made for each individual patient. So we have the technology now to do this. People have custom crowns that they put in their teeth, so why can't we do custom knee replacements? So I use ConforMIS, and so ConforMIS is the name of a company that had this idea. So my disclosure is I trained with the guys who started the company. So when I was in Boston, I worked with a lot of different surgeons. I worked with the guys who were the designers for DePue. I worked with a consultant for Stryker. I worked with a consultant for Zimmer. And I worked with two guys who started the company called ConforMIS. So that's how I got exposed to it. And so when I was there, I was like, gee, I don't know why someone wouldn't do this. Like, I mean, this just makes total sense. It made the knee surgery seem easier, and it also made more sense to me because you're basically putting back the patient's anatomy. Sorry. So the hard part with this is they had to figure out how to manufacture individualized implants for people on a large scale. It's actually kind of technically very hard to do. So this is how they get around the patent issue with the curve. So as I said before, every company has a patented curve. The thing is that what they do is they make three individual curves for that patient. So a patient gets a CT scan, and then your inside curve, your trochlear curve, and then your lateral curve all get made into the implant. So the implant itself has three different curves to it, which are basically reproducing what your native curves are. And this is the slide. I always tell people, if you're ever going to look at anything and get anything out of this is what the company does. They get a CT scan of your knee, and this is what most people's knees look like. This is what my knee looks like. I took an x-ray of my knee. Your inside condyle goes down further, your lateral condyle is recessed up, and it has to go back with that slide I was saying before. When you bend your knee, you pivot around the inside of your knee, and your lateral side of your knee rolls back. And this is what your knee looks like when it's flexed. So what they do is they just make the implant look just like your knee. And that's the whole idea behind it. It looks just like your knee. So it's designed to prevent all these problems of overhang. It's designed to be flush with the bone. And basically it's designed to be your same shape and contour. So the ligaments in your knee, which have been designed for your knee when you develop through childhood, they don't change. And so a lot of times what you have to do with an off-the-shelf knee is you have to adjust your ligaments and do releases and stuff to get your knee to be balanced. With this, you don't really have to do any of that because the implant's made for your knee. So this again, just another slide. These are some pictures I took. These are the ones I passed around. So this one here, you can see this is an off-the-shelf knee. You can see how this is, they're symmetric. This is a symmetric thing. And this person, they didn't have a lot of offset. You can see they have quite a bit of offset over here to their lateral side. This is just a little, can't really get a good sense of this, but you can see how this medial part of the knee comes down further, and this one's recessed more. And you can see how this is a symmetric implant. And then the other thing with this is the polyethylenes or the plastic that come with this with these implants, they're made to match the femur. So you can see how this is thicker than this one over here. So every one of these I put in, it's kind of interesting to see the shape of the plastics you put in because they're offset. They're never flat. But all the other companies, when they make a symmetric implant, all their implants are flat. It's kind of interesting. So, I mean, basically this is a knee replacement. So someone's got really bad arthritis. This is what it looks like on an x-ray, and this is what it looks like with a knee replacement with a ConforMIS knee. And you can see how it fits perfectly side to side. And then this person doesn't have a lot of offset to their condyle, but that's what it looks like. And then here's the lateral, the same thing. So you can see how it fits flush up to the tip of the bone, comes all the way up here. There's no overhang. It's got your patient's anatomic slope. That's the other thing that's really interesting. So when I get these eye views, which I was passing around, they're just really interesting to see how goofy shaped people's knees are. As a surgeon, a lot of times, if you do a traditional off-the-shelf knee, people are always like, well, I always cut my knee in 5 degrees of slope. But the one thing that's very interesting is some people have no slope to their tibia, and some people have 12 degrees of slope to your tibia. So the spectrum of people's knee shapes is very interesting, and the more I keep doing these implants, the more sense it makes to me to have a customized knee. So basically what you have to have done is you have to have a CT scan. So some of the people who are against implants like this say, well, you're driving up the cost of healthcare because people have to have a CT scan to have this done. And I would argue, yes, that is true. It is more money because you're having a CT scan. There's some exposure to radiation. But if you prevent a patient from having to have it revised and you have an implant that works well, then I think it's worth the cost. These are the eye views I passed around, and they kind of show you the patient's slope. They show you how much resection you have to make when you're doing the surgery. There's just more of those. And the biggest thing with this is the implant's bone preserving. So because the implant's made for you, you're not taking any extra bone off. So it's very, very specific when you do this. It's actually really amazing how little bone you take away. I mean, you're still doing a knee replacement, you're taking bone away. But the amount of bone I take off is tiny. And it's just because the implant's made to fit. It's not, you're not putting in something that you're trying to get to fit. This thing's fit for you. So I'm gonna show you how to do a knee replacement, kind of like I said earlier. It's all rated G, there's no bloody pictures. So how do you go from here to here? So basically this is the end of a femur. What you do is you put on, and the thing I also like about this implant, it has all these custom jigs that go on your knee, and they're only made for your knee, and you basically just follow them in order. You go F1 all the way through F6, then you go T1 all the way to T6. So it actually makes the surgery pretty easy. So you put F1 on, and this is, so after F1, you put an F2, you pin the F4 block, then this in someone when they're arthritic, is basically bare bone like I showed you in that picture before. So usually you'll have, you know, a big bare spot of bone here. You have this over here, the cartilage looks kind of rough. So then you remove the cartilage from the end of the bone. It always has a step cut here, and this is again part of the design to save bone. You put on the F4 guide, you pin this in place, you remove just the top here of the arthritis, you move the bottom part of the arthritis here. F5, remove the arthritis back here, and there you go, the implant fits on. It actually makes it it's much more simplified because there's not a lot of moving parts. I mean, basically, I'm not sizing your knee, I'm not doing anything, it's just it's almost like doing a knee replacement by number. And it always fits, always. I've never seen it not fit. And then do the same thing in the tibia. So you basically put this tibial guide on, and this tibial guide has these feet that sit on top, and then it also has this ridge that sits along the front of your bone, so it always fits, and it's always aligned with your mechanical axis. And then you remove 2 millimeters of bone off your tibia. This thing is the tibial base plate. So basically what you do is you get this, so it's lined up around the outside periphery of your tibia, so you can't make the rotation, you can't do it wrong because it only fits one way. So one of the things that people have a problem with is how much rotation to put on your tibia when you're using an off-the-shelf knee. With this, you can only put it in one place. And this is just, there's a lot of studies on this too, basically saying if you mess up the tibial rotation, people have problems with their knee replacement. And basically what it does is they make an implant that fits your knee. So it has all this offset built in the condyle. So they just make an implant that fits your knee. And like I said, you can only put it on one way. And then the alignment's corrected. So a lot of times people ask me the question, well, if my knee is crooked now, will it be straight afterwards? And so the goal of doing a knee replacement is you want this to be a neutral mechanical axis, and you want this to be a neutral mechanical axis with your hip. And most of the time, that's how people are born. But over time, when they get arthritis, they start to drift in either more bow-legged or more valgus. So And then the only decision you make as a surgeon, and you have to do these steps obviously in order, is what how thick a plastic to put in. So with this implant, it's so precise, the only decision I make is if I'm gonna put a 6, 7, or 8 millimeter plastic in. I mean, that's like, I mean, it's hard to tell the difference really when you're doing it, but that's how precise this is. When you do a traditional off-the-shelf knee replacement, usually you have the options of doing an 8 millimeter, 10 millimeter, 12 millimeter, 14 millimeter, 17 millimeter, 20 millimeter, 22, 24, and then 27. That's your options when you do it. There's that much variety when you're doing those. This, my only option is 6, 7, or 8, and it's almost always 6. Very rarely do I put a 7 or 8 in, because it's just, it's that precise. And the thing that I like about it and everyone likes about it that does surgery with me is that it comes in a box. So your implant comes in a box, it's got your name on it, and this is all that comes in the box except for these metal pieces, they come in the tray. So basically all these things we toss at the end of the case, so they're just basically 3D printed things, we throw them away. I usually give patients this and this piece down here just because I like to show it to them. So like today I did surgery, I got done, I'm like, here's what your implant looks like. Some people think it's cool, some people are just like, what do I do with this? But and I do think it's better because you're not washing things. So if you look at it doing a traditional knee replacement, you'll have 6 or 7 pans of instruments. And so like every single time you do a surgery, they have to be washed, cleaned, processed. There's always a possibility of something being contaminated. Where this, it comes, it's a single use thing. You open up everything, get done, you throw it away. A little wasteful, but really the amount of plastic in this box is small relative to the amount of waste that goes into washing all those implants. This is a very extreme example, but you can see this is what a ConforMIS knee replacement looks like in someone's right knee, and this patient over here had an off-the-shelf knee. Again, it's a pretty extreme example, but this is a big guy. So I think the people who really benefit from this are bigger bone people or all small petite women because they're the more extremes of the spectrum of their sizes. But you can see all this, you know, it just doesn't look right for him. So what to expect after surgery? I always tell people the surgery's, you know, an hour, hour and a half long. The hard part afterwards is all the therapy. But typically you're in the hospital for 1 to 3 days. A lot of it depends on, people always ask, when can I go home? And really what it has to do is when you're safe. So medically you're safe, the therapists have worked with you and you're ready to go home in terms of you're gonna be able to take care of yourself. You'll be able to put full weight on your knee afterwards. Long-term, how you do, a lot of it depends on how well you do with therapy. So some people really put the time in, they really dedicate themselves to doing well, and it does pay off in the end. You can't be passive in this process. Most of the time in 6 weeks, I see everyone back in 6 weeks. Most of the time people are getting around pretty good. I mean, they're just like, I'm doing okay, I'm not 100% yet, but I'm really happy I had this done, and people are seeing the light at the end of the tunnel, but it's a definite dedication of your time. So I think that one of the best things we're doing at the hospital that I think really makes a big difference, which has helped my practice grow a lot, is our approach to pain. So these are big surgeries, they hurt, and there's things you can do to help prevent that. And I think the biggest thing we're doing is almost all my patients get a spinal anesthetic. So basically you're technically awake during surgery, you're breathing on your own, your heart's beating on your own, but you're numb, very similar to when patients have babies and they go into labor so they can't feel their legs when they're going through labor. After a knee replacement, then generally what we do is we do an adductor canal nerve block. So basically the nerves that feed the front of your knee, we can block them with a catheter. And it's like a little ball that you have in a purse that goes around your shoulder for 2 days. And then I also, at the time of your surgery, I inject your knee with a bunch of injectable stuff. So it's like Marcaine and Exparel and things like that, which make your leg numb. So most of the time people wake up after surgery and they're like, I actually don't have a whole lot of pain. And it's just because everything's numb. So I think a lot of patients' fears about knee replacement surgery is the pain afterwards. And it is a big surgery and it is painful. But I think we're trying to be very aggressive with taking care of that and helping people through that because it's painful. And I just think this is what I would want done for me. So that's why we're doing it. It does take a lot of extra time. So if you're trying to do 20 joints in a day, you can't do this because doing a spinal takes a while for it to set up. Doing a nerve block takes a while for it to set up. This is what I would want done if it was me. So the other thing I always tell people too is that to have one of these knee replacements, you just can't show up and say, I want a knee replacement tomorrow. So it takes it's a process to getting these made. So you have to get a CT scan. Then once your knee is scanned, it has to be a specific scan. So that's the other thing too. Like it has to be a validated center for their scan. So our center is validated. There's a couple of hospitals around that I have patients that come from very frequently that I have validated, but you just can't come in with a CT scan because they have to get a scan of your hip, your knee, and your ankle because they got to get your alignment correct. And then basically they send it off to the company. They create your knee, so they have an engineer that designs your knee. Then they personalize the implant, so it takes about 4 to 5 weeks for them to make it, and then they send it to us in the mail and it comes to our hospital. It takes 6 weeks at the earliest from the time you get your CT scan done. But in the meantime, there's a lot of other appointments you'll have, so we'll set you up to see your primary care doctor for a preoperative history and physical. We also have a joint camp that we require everyone to attend. So when I first came to the hospital, we set up a joint camp, and it wasn't mandatory. And now we make it mandatory because we just found that people who didn't go to the joint camp didn't tend to do as well afterwards because they were asking a lot of questions that they really should have known. So we made it a part of our preoperative education process. And then we get you back on your feet. So is it for everyone? That's the other question I get usually at the end of this. It's not for everyone. So who are the people that it's not for? This is a patient of mine. He told me I could show him his x-rays. This is a great guy, farmer, and he waited as long as he could. His wife basically brought him in kicking and screaming to have his knees done, but he was really debilitated. This is his preoperative x-ray. Both his right and his left knees look the same. So the reason why this guy, I told him he could not have a custom knee replacement is because you can see that his ligaments have been compromised. So this guy is basically shifted off medially. His MCL is no longer functioning. So when I would examine him preoperatively, he would have nothing would stop his leg. I mean, his leg was basically completely loose. So the problem with that is you need to have some kind of revision style implant. So what I used for him for his first time knee replacement is a constrained implant. So basically this is, you know, this knee over here. So he's got a stem, and he's also got this little metal peg up here. And that metal peg makes it so his knee can't wobble back and forth. So he has a constrained implant. It's more like a hinge. But I told him if I did a traditional knee replacement like this, he'd have it revised because it would not work and it wouldn't function. So, but he's doing okay. I mean, he's definitely not having anywhere near the pain he had beforehand, and he's able to do everything else he wants to do. He did a lot of therapy afterwards, but so it's not for everyone. And there are some people saying, you know, what is the point of this? No more new wheel. Why do we need this? And I just tell people, like, if we're not trying to get better, then what are we doing? And I think orthopedics lags behind the rest of medicine because they're doing some really cool stuff in pretty much every other field. And this is probably the only really cool new thing that they're doing in orthopedics. We have other things that they're doing, but it's not to the same degree. I mean, we're not putting valves in through the vein, you know. I mean, it's really cool, some of the cardiology things they're doing. I always tell people, you know, how far away is Platteville? This is, you know, if you look at from Dubuque, would you go to a Hawkeye game? Probably not a lot of Hawkeye fans around here, but there are a lot down by Platteville. So, you know, it's 1 hour and 40 minutes to a Hawkeye game. If you're going from Dubuque to Madison to a Badger game, it's 1 hour and 33 minutes. If you're going from the hotel here to Southwest Health, it's 47 minutes. And like Jamie was saying, he commutes that every day. So if you're going to invest 3 months in rehab in your knee and doing it, I'd say just come down and have a conversation with me. You don't necessarily have to have me do your knee replacement, but if you're interested in this or interested in anything else, I'd be happy to talk to you about it. So that's all I got.